Achan is really the proper pronunciation. His name was also Achor, same word actually, and that's because of the spelling. What's the name, what is the meaning of the name? Does anybody know what it means? Ah, very good. Oh, you're so good. Oh, she is. She's on the slide. She's a clever girl, she goes far, I tell you. Okay, let's talk about Jericho. If I had to put a year on it, it would be about 1415 BC. Very hard to nail precisely, very hard. But around about that time, well, right at the end of the 15th century BC is when this happened, when they took Jericho. Jericho was a fortified city. It was the main city of the Canaanites. And you got to understand, I should have put a map there, if you would come over the River Jordan from the east side, your main obstacle is Jericho. So what does Jericho mean?
What is what?
Whilst you think about that. $20 if you come up with it, and if not, it's an extra $10 in the bag. Yeah. Okay. I'll leave that phone alone. So they march around Jericho. You by all means abstain from the accursed things. Anything that belonged to the Canaanites, those in Jericho, don't touch it. Leave it alone. Lest you become accursed when you take the accursed thing. So what God is saying to Joshua, to the Israelites, don't get tempted to keep anything that you come across. Everything about Jericho is accursed, for except one thing was not accursed, or one person. Anybody?
Three.
Achan.
Come on. You're not listening. Who was not accursed from Jericho?
Ahab.
Ahab.
Sorry.
Oh, you get back to your Bibles. That was a harlot who did actually hide two of the Jewish spies. What was her name? Rahab. She married a man by the name of Salmon, who became they were the parents of Boaz, the husband of Ruth.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Everybody in the house of Rahab was protected. So, but you were not to touch anything and make the camp of Israel a curse. If you do that, if you grab anything at all. Now here is the point. When God specifically tells you it is a curse, leave it alone. That's the lesson here. And you will trouble it. And we know the name of meaning of Achan is
trouble.
And you haven't found the other one yet. No, I know. It means it's moon. Stop you looking, yeah. $10. But all the silver and the gold and the vessels of bronze and iron, they would be consecrated to the Lord. And they would go into the treasury for the Lord for safekeeping, because ultimately all this would become part of the temple that was one day to be rebuilt. Do you understand? That's why it was consecrated. And they burned the city and all that was in it with fire, and only the silver, the gold, and the vessels of bronze and iron went into the treasury of the house of the Lord. Are we crystal clear what happened at Jericho? When it comes to the goods. Okay, let's have a look at the walls. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. It wasn't by the Israelites, they couldn't take a city. They didn't know how to do that. They had no implementations of war to do that. It was impossible. They had to starve them out by besieging them. They had enough people, by 1.5 million, but they didn't have the capacity of taking a city. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down and they were encircling it for 7 days, once each day, that would mean even a Sabbath day, they were encircling Jericho. And on one day, the seventh day from doing that, not necessarily the seventh day Sabbath, unlikely, the seventh day of encircling that particular city, the walls fell down. They had to blow the trumpets. Every time when they walked around that city, they had to be quiet, like being in church, right? But when you're asked to sing, you sing, right? So on that day, the seventh day of doing this, on the seventh time they went around the city, they blew the trumpet, the shofar, and it was the long haul, and then they started to shout because they were commanded to do that, and the walls came tumbling down. And every single person, with the exception of Rahab and those in her household or in her house, perished. Everybody knew, including those of Jericho, that it was an act of God bringing the walls down. That was an act of God. Everybody clear on that? But the Bible goes on to say, the children of Israel committed a trespass regarding the accursed thing. Something went wrong. For Achan, now note the names, I'm sorry about the names, but they're there for a purpose. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, and of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things. So the anger of the Lord burned against whom? The children of Israel. Achan did it. But God was angry with who? Yeah, do you understand? This was the whole congregation of Israel. See, we think when we sin, that's bad. And so that's our problem. No. It's the problem of the church, the whole church. You understand? I hope it sinks in. You go wrong, you do wrong, the church has a responsibility. Not a responsibility just for dealing with the offense, but also particularly to prevent the offense. We talked about unity in the class, didn't we? If you have that unity, you won't have an Achan. Or a heart, whatever you call it. Not likely. Now, this is the fourth generation. In fact, you can tell by the generation, Carmi, Zabdi, Zerah, and then Judah, you can tell that this man, this Achan, was actually beyond middle-aged. And I've put it up there, so in case I forgot. He was not a young guy, so his children would have been grown up. You miss me? You remember what I just said? Okay, because that becomes important. So what was his sin? Oh, well, you'd say that was greed. But here it is. Israel is considered guilty because of the transgression of one of its members. Israel shares in the guilt. Guilt is not transferable. It's not being transferred from Achan to Israel. Now Israel is already guilty because they have an Achan. Something has gone wrong already. Are you listening? This is how you're going to read this. Now, there's a next little city which only has a population of 12,000. That's what the record, it's in chapter 8, it is recorded of the book of Joshua. It's interesting, that's not a big city compared to Jericho. They sorted it out, they spied it out, and they only needed a few thousand men, warriors, to knock that city over. And of course, that's what they were going to do, and hoping to do, they approached the city, and lo and behold, the gates opened, and out came the men of iron. They fought like lions. They fought them off, and 38 of those, the Jewish soldiers, they died. The Israelite soldiers, they died. And they were afraid. They ran. That's bad news. Very bad. This has enormous consequences. Have a look at that. Success cannot come when there is sin in the camp. That's lesson number one, yeah? No, number two. Number one is we share in the guilt. Number two, we can't, as a congregation, we can't, as a people, progress and prosper if there is sin in the camp. And just exchange the word camp for church here. Israel is considered guilty because of the transgression of one of its members. Success cannot come when there is sin in the camp. For one man's sin, the displeasure of God will rest upon what? That comes from Patriarchs and Prophets, and the reference is there, page 493. It's an interesting statement. That's how she sees it. You know, she's right. See what this was inspired. Till the transgression is sorted out. When there is transgression in the church, it needs to be sorted. The church has a duty. But it should by all means prevent it. And if we have that unity that we were talking about this morning, it's less likely to ever occur. And put away. We have to deal with it. You cannot close your eyes, you have to deal with it. And so that's the way a goodly Babylonian garment was one of the articles. It would have been a magnificent coat. Would have been fantastic. The problem was he never got to wear it. He didn't. Such is greed. And even if he wasn't found out, a couple of months later, you suddenly walk around with a garment that is way over the top, designer, gold, everything. How are you going to explain where you got it? This becomes important. If Achan could have gotten away with this, and he'd be walking down the streets after they sorted out the Canaanites, and he has this very exclusive, very expensive, you know, made in Babylon. And so, what would that say to the people? Well, that's all right. Nothing happened to him. You get away. God understands. You'll get away with a bit. Too good to pass up. Yeah? Do you understand the mindset? What had God said about the stuff that was there in Jericho? All of it was a curse, for except the metals they were used to be consecrated to God for the temple. You understand? Well, he didn't do that. Then Joshua tore his clothes. Have a look at this. It's quite fascinating. And he fell to the earth on his face before the ark of the Lord. Now you got to understand, this is only in the ark is in the tent. Until evening. So he doesn't see the ark. It's in front of the curtain there before the ark. And he lies there. I don't know how long, what time of the day he started. But he must have been there for hours. He and the elders of Israel. They all had, it made a huge impact, that defeat of Ai. It was terrible. They put dust on their heads. Now have a look at this. So he tore his clothes. Now a Jew still, Orthodox still does that. They just now won't do it, but they pull this and then tear it. You understand? Left side preferably where the heart is, like a broken heart. Do you understand? Then you put ashes on your head. That means you are really mourning. You are really in a bad, bad, bad way. Do you understand that? Job did that, but then he lost 10 kids, hey? To begin with. Yeah. Yeah. So he put dust on his heads. Now, Joshua said, oh, alas, oh Lord, why have you brought these people over the Jordan at all? Listen to the way he's talking. Listen. Why did you bring us here? Why did you bring us here? To deliver us into the hands of the Amorites, you know, collective name for all the Canaanites. To destroy us. That we had been content to dwell on the other side of the Jordan. Blimey. God brings them in the promised land. He gave them Jericho. Something went pear-shaped. True. Instead of trying to find out why, oh poor us. What's going to happen to us? Have a look at this. This is Joshua. Lord, what shall I say when Israel turns its backs before its enemy? They run away from their enemies. The Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear it, and what will happen? They will surround us. They cut off our name. In other words, they kill us all. And they will. They keep doing that. And then, here is a thought for God. I like that. Then what will you do for what? What does he say? Your great name. You know, that should have been right at the beginning. When trouble strikes because of misbehavior, we think of what how it affects us. We don't think how it affects God's reputation, doesn't it? I hope you can get this. This is a fundamental spiritual problem that still prevails. It's massive. You think of yourself, you don't think of the name of God. We never think about God suffering. We only think how we might suffer. And this is not a very spiritual condition here, but he's devastated. He is devastated. And so, God speaks. I love the way God speaks to him. So the Lord said to Joshua, get up. I like that. Sometimes the best spiritual advice that you can have as a people, get up, not down, after. Do you understand? In other words, do something. I have people say, oh, Pastor, can you pray with me? I feel like saying to them what God said to Joshua. Why don't you do something about it? Yeah? This is how God feels. He says, why do you lie on your face? What's that going to do? You have a problem in the camp. Israel has sinned. And you, the head of Israel, I've appointed you. Israel has sinned, and they have transgressed my commandments, and which I commanded them. Well, one of them did anyway. But God holds everybody responsible. I think this is a huge lesson. Yeah? I hope it gets through. For they have even taken some of the accursed things, and they have both stolen and deceived. Two things. They have stolen and deceived, and they have also put it amongst their own stuff. Now, two things. What have they done wrong? They have stolen and they have deceived. Give me the definition for stealing. There's a commandment against it. You should know the definition. Comes in many different forms, but it is like, I don't mind a bit of feedback, so you stay awake. You understand?
So,
come on, what's stealing? I don't mind that at all, Joe.
Yeah.
Oh, it has to do with coveting. Stealing is finding something before it is lost.
Oh.
Can you remember that? If you remember that, you'll do well.
I remember that, but I'm telling you Woolworths.
Yes, okay. It'll save Woolworths a lot of money, I know it. Okay, now listen. Therefore, the deception was to put it amongst their own stuff, by the way. Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies. Why not? Because God wasn't with them. But turned their backs before the enemy. Even your courage will fail. Not your capacity to fight, you'll lose that too. But your courage, you'll lose it as well. Because you know you're wrong with him. And you know it. Because they have become doomed to destruction. This is not just a bad day. They are doomed to destruction. Joshua and the elders knew this gets around. These Israelites are a goner. Get it? That's the story about this. Neither will I be with you anymore. God is not going to be with you anymore. Unless you destroy the accursed from among you, deal with it and root it out. So get up, he says to Joshua. Now sanctify the people. How are you going to sanctify these people? Sanctify these people. But what you do it this way. You say to them, sanctify yourselves tomorrow. You tell them, they clean themselves up because tomorrow is going to be a very special day. They have to sanctify them because, thus says the Lord God of Israel, have a look what he says, there is an accursed thing in your midst, O Israel, and you cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the accursed things from amongst you. You got to clean yourself up. And in the morning, therefore, you shall be brought according to your tribes. You see, what was going to happen? He was going to gather the whole congregation, all the tribes. Now you sanctify yourself. Now to a Hebrew that is, wash yourself. Wash your clothes. Iron them. I don't know how they did that. But proper clothes. A bit like, a little bit like going to church. Clean yourself up. Nice. Because it's not how you present yourself to your brothers and sisters. It too. But this is how you present yourself to whom? To God. Respect. So nice and clean. It gives them the right attitude. You know, before they received the commandments, that's exactly what God said. Get some clean clothes on. They were directed to do that. It is a matter of decorum and deportment when we appear before God. And we often lose sight of that. But we should never, never lose sight of that. So in the morning, you shall be brought by your tribes. Now have a look at this. Have a look at this. That means Achan was amongst them. Wouldn't you know? I want you to think, everything that I tell you now, the man Achan, the one who did this, who knew there was a defeat, the one who realized, oh, it's because of some of the accursed is taken, who obviously, I don't know, did he sleep well that night? What's he hoping for? To get away with it? Now put yourself in the shoes or sandals of that man for a minute. It will appeal to you. And it shall be that the tribe which the Lord takes, this was done by Lot. This was a figure way of figuring out. Lot, provided God ordered it, it was perfectly legal. Other than that, Lot, of course, is only, you understand, Lot is only, it's not having any value. But God has to be in it. Is that clear? Does everybody understand that? God has to be in it. So by Lot. So they were all arrayed, and then the lots come up. And then the lots come up. And it shall be that the tribe which the Lord takes that come according to the families. And then once they have the families, that is the clans that make up that tribe, they go to particular households. And once they get to the household, it narrows down even further. They will then, from the household, the Lord will take. This is all done by Lot, man by man. Can you understand the process that they have to go through? The guilty party has not come forward. Hasn't done that. If he had any brains, he would. God knows. He doesn't see it that way. He must hope he gets away with it. This is the inevitable sinfulness. The epitome of sinfulness. The belief that you can commit sin and you will get away with it. I have a comment of that later from the spirit of prophecy. Then it shall be that he who is taken with the accursed thing, have a look at that, shall be what? Burned with fire. Now this is announced the day before. You would think that he would have a private audience with Joshua and said, I'm sorry, it was me. That would have been the honorable thing to do, wouldn't it? No, it's not. That's not what in him was. He and all that he has, so whatever he has starts, is now unclean. Common, not good enough for God. That's basically the because he has transgressed the covenant of the Lord. That's in extension, of course, the Ten Commandments, but the agreement that they wouldn't touch anything at all from the people of Jericho. And because he's done a disgraceful thing in Israel. So Joshua rose early in the morning, make an early start. There's nothing like an early start. And so he lines them all up. And he brought Israel by the tribes. And the tribe of Judah. Tribe of Judah. Who was of the tribe of Judah? Achan. What was the clan of Judah? It fell on the Zarites. That's narrowing down. Then he brought the family of the Zarites, man by man, and Zabdi was taken, and that is his father's household, man by man, and then Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, the son of the tribe of Judah was taken. It narrows it down, this man who should have known a lot better, who went through the desert for 40 years, should have known a lot better. He had seen all the miracles. He had seen all the miracles. If he hadn't seen the miracles, you might excuse him, but he had seen the miracles of God, how he providentially provided the manna, how he providentially provided the water, in a place where you find no water, providentially had given light at nighttime, the pillar of fire above the sanctuary, a God who had provided shade in a country where you cannot find shade. It's a desert, for heaven's sake, and he had shaded them. Is the pillar of the cloud. God had, their clothes had not wear out, their sandals had not wear out, nothing was not done that should not have been done. Everything was done by God. Unbelievable. And then he does this. Now Joshua said to Achan, my son, I want you to see the language here. Don't get hard on people when they've done wrong. Be not the judge. My son, I beg you, give glory to the Lord God of Israel. Make confession to him. Look at the language. And tell me now what you have done, and please do not hide it from me. Why would you do that? The man has been found out. He is not in denial, but he was up to the point when he was picked. Would that be fair? So here you have it. Now Joshua says, I beg of you, my son, give glory to the Lord God of Israel. How can you, in the position that Achan is in, how can you give glory to the Lord God? How do you do that? I want you to think about that. We'll come back to that. Make confession to him. Does God know? Oh, yeah, the moment he laid his hands on it. The moment he covered it. For sure. God even knew where he hid it. So, yeah, no problem. There's something missing with Achan. Now he says this, indeed I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel. Is Achan, this is my point, is he repenting here? I want to see what you say.
Is he what?
Repenting. Is Achan, is he now repenting from what he has done?
Sorry he was caught.
He was sorry he was caught. I like that. Was he repentant? Do I have any takers at all?
Yes, he was.
Oh, he was. I have one person who looks sympathetic on this poor man that has been found out finally at last when he couldn't get away anymore. Look at the next one. And this is what I have done. He spells it out. When I saw among the spoils a beautiful Babylonian garment, the one that you don't get at Kmart. It is just so expensive.
Yeah.
He says 200 shekels of silver. I'm not sure how much it is, but a shekel is about 11 grams, so that's 2 ounces. Start adding up. And a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels. 50 shekels of gold. That is not bad.
It's good.
It's good. You can pay out your mortgage, we said, if you had a mortgage.
Yeah.
And if you haven't got one yet, well, that would be a deposit and you can get a mortgage. This is good money. 40 years in the desert would not have paid this. Okay. I coveted them. Did he know he coveted them? He's confessing, isn't he? And I took them. And there are hidden in the earth in the midst of my tent. You know, I'll save you looking, I'll tell you where it is. And the silver, be careful as you dig it out, the silver is underneath it. Question. Did Achan repent? Yes or no?
Yes.
I have a yes.
No.
No. Mate, I think you're on your own here.
Yes.
Well, this is the thing. Judas. I have betrayed innocent blood. Did he confess?
Yes.
Yeah, he did confess. But confessing is not the equivalent of repentance. Peter ran away to the very spot where Jesus went through the ordeal in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he was heartbroken for denying his Lord. Did Peter repent?
Yes.
Yes, he did. And the rest of his life was a testimony to that. Repentance is more than a sorrow for sin and its consequences. Repentance is a sorrow of sin and a desire, an intent, and an action to turn away from it. Yeah? The regret of the sin is not what it does to you. It's not about that. It's what it does to him. Yeah? He is the one who gets hurt. He went for you to the cross, right? You are hurt. The Bible says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit. We all have done it. And sometimes still do. Can you see the difference? Okay. Now, the rest is pretty hard stuff, but you have to see this. Achan and his household are now destroyed. So, Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan the son of Zer. By the way, right at the end of the 1,000 years from now, when there is a scene that you should imagine, because you will be there, that which side of the wall is determined by how much that sermon gets through to you. Really, it's that important. But when you see that billions of people standing there and they have endeavored to surround the holy city of Jerusalem, and then fire comes down from heaven. Just before that, did you know that every knee will bow, including Satan? Because God is just in what he is doing. This is a miniature end time scenario. What if God did not act the way he has directed Israel to deal with it? There would be Achams around every corner. You understand? God is teaching, impressing upon the mind, I cannot save you if you go down this path. And then the rest is up to you. Note this. The silver, the garment, the gold, all that he touched, his sons and daughters. This is why I asked you to understand that the man was well in his advanced middle years. His sons and daughters would have been grown up. My point is this, in his tent, would they have known? Yeah, likely to, isn't it? How would you hide it with a family living in one tent? That beautiful Babylonian garment. Maybe it was for the missus, I don't know. How would you hide the money? I don't think that's possible. The Bible is silent on it, but I think they knew. And like father, like son, like daughter, like maybe it was a family trade. The whole family. The other thing, his oxen, his donkeys, his sheep, the tent doesn't matter, but these are animals. The oxen, the donkeys, and the sheep, they were included. You know what God is saying here? If you have the mind of Achan, whatever you touch, it becomes unclean. Do you understand what he's saying here? This is a very severe rebuke. And we've got to understand this. I hope you get this. And all that he had, and they brought him to the valley of Achor. Now Achor is the same as Achan, which is the valley of trouble. And that valley was named after the execution of this whole family. Sad. And Joshua said, "What have you? Why have you troubled us? The Lord will trouble you this day." Indeed, he did. So all Israel stoned him with stones. Not all 1.5 million had a chance, but you know, on behalf. And they burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. And I noticed, and they raised over them a great heap of stones. Why did they do that? Still to this day, that's the day of writing, so it was still the decades after when this story was recorded. And the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger, and therefore the name of that place has been called the Valley of Achor to this day. This is a very sobering story, isn't it? Oh yes. But you know what God did was an act of love. It stamped the Achan sin that would have thrived otherwise had he not decidedly dealt with this. It's very hard. Notice, just a couple of quick thoughts before I close. Achan acknowledged his guilt when it was too late. He had been found out. He had seen the armies of Israel return from Ai defeated, and he knew why. He had listened to the proclamation that a great crime had been committed, and he knew it was him. There is a vast difference between admitting facts after they have been proved, isn't it? And confessing sins known only to ourselves and to God. His confession only served to show that his punishment was just. The only reason why God will insist that every knee will bow for him in a little over 1,000 years from now is that a universe can see that God is merciful but also just. Also just. There was no genuine repentance of sin, no contrition, absolutely not, no change of purpose, no abhorrence of evil. If Achan would have gotten away with this, he would have used the gold, the silver, and the metals that he stole from God. He would have worn at one time or another, or flogged it in a sale, the goodly Babylonian garment that didn't belong to him. Josephus, the Jewish historian, 1st century AD, said that this garment was laced with golden threads. I don't know where he got that from, but that's what he said. Here's some thoughts. So as long as they can conceal their transgression from their fellow man, men like Achan feel secure. Now have a look at this. Flatter themselves that God will not be strict to mark iniquity. That's a mistake. When the records of heaven shall be opened, when they shall be opened, the judge will not in words declare to man his guilt, but will cast one penetrating, convicting glance, and every deed, every transaction of life will be vividly expressed upon the memory of the wrongdoer. Can you imagine? That's the judgment. And there's a scene there that I can't begin to paint. But there is God, and he looks at these millions upon hundreds of millions, billions of people surrounding this whole wonderful, incredible city. Oh, they desire to take it by violence, and they can't, and they know. And one look at every single person amongst them will intelligently understand why they have been left outside the wall, outside the gate, outside the city. Yeah? They'll know. You don't want to be amongst that number. The sins hidden from the knowledge of man, then will be proclaimed to the whole world. There will be facilities in the New Jerusalem where men can intelligently examine why someone was lost. And the information, you might say, is under the Freedom of Information Act, so to speak. But not your sins. When they are forgiven, they are covered. You don't even remember them anymore. And so where do we need to go? Secret sins? No, there is no such thing. Every secret sin, it says, I saw that, signed by God on it. No question about it. Turning from sin, no such thing as secret sins. Turning of sin is where the real power is. The power is in the forgiveness and the awareness of that forgiveness. He who has been much forgiven, he or she will love much. Do you remember Jesus saying that? Okay. Achan's sin? Well, we dealt with it. The book of Malachi, just a quick, I can't help this one. I, the Lord your God, do not change. Do you know that God, the God of Achan, is still the same God of us here today, this congregation here in Maroubra? Will a man rob God? Yes. How will we rob you? In tithes and offering. Just one way you could rob God. Achan just stole because it was dedicated to God and it didn't bother him. But this is another one that may be worthy of a consideration. God says, you come back to me, you return to me, and I will return to you. You make up again. When there is sin in the camp, don't be afraid to go to God. But if you don't go, be afraid you don't. Can you see the difference? That's when you are having good reasons to be afraid. Well, different walls. There are different barriers. So there's the status, there's the greed, there's the envy, there is the pride. A very big is unforgiven, anger, and here's the biggest one of them all, resentment. Not acceptable to God. When we put our problems in God's hands, he puts his peace in our heart. What you and I are after is the peace in our heart. That all these things, all these walls that we have between us and God will really come down. And the bottom line is, any wall cannot fall until the walls of your heart fall. You have to be willing. You have to be willing to change, to let go. Even to that which you think you may be entitled to, but you are not. And so, choose you this day. I love this statement. Be very strong, he said, decades later to the people. As he got older, Joshua said, be careful to obey all that is written in the books of the law of Moses, you know, including, of course, the Ten Commandments. He says, you know that with all your heart and all your soul that not one of all the good promises the Lord God gave you has failed. He said, God never failed you. Every promise has been fulfilled. That is true of your life as well. Every promise has been fulfilled. Not one has failed. But if by serving, if serving the Lord seems to be undesirable to you, he says, choose you for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served, that is from Mesopotamia, beyond the Euphrates, or the gods of the Amorites in which lands you are living. He knew they were going to stray from the true God. And he's imploring them to stay with the true God. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. You know, you can walk away and you say, me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Then that has been a good morning. God is good. True? All the time. There's no doubt about it. But remember, a good God destroys, he has to, those who do not respond. And that is the great object lesson of the story here of Achan. May God bless you. You see us. Heavenly Father, we come to you because we know you are our Father, and we thank you for the love that we can see in your dealings there with Achan of old. And we understand that we fall under the same rules, the same law. Lord, we have often sinned and fallen short, and we ask that you forgive us. But we really want to turn from things wrong and do things right. We really want to give up to be wrong and to be right. But we need your help. Strengthen us, keep us strong, do what is necessary in our lives, that it may yield to the influence of the Holy Spirit, who then breaks down every wall, and that we will be in harmony with you and therefore also in harmony with each other. Bless us now, Lord, and bless also the refreshments that we are about to enjoy. Thank you for those so willing to prepare, and that it may nourish our bodies and be with the fellowship. Bring us together again for worship and study in this place, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.